basis on which the current European guidelines came up, that patients with a left bundle branch block morphology, wide QRS and heart failure, if they have even a functional class 2 heart failure, and they are ambulatory and they are on best medical therapy, the QRS duration of more than 150 milliseconds is chosen as a cutoff. But if a person is class 3 despite optimal medical therapy and the QRS duration is even between 120 to 150, you can go ahead with an ICD where a survival benefit is seen. Among patients with non-left bundle branch morphology, you need to have a QRS morphology, I mean duration of more than 150 milliseconds, and for those patients with non-LBBB, you need additional refinement of this criteria. One thing is clear, narrow QRS, there is no benefit from giving a CRT. Please don't even consider. Now, this set the stage that patients with a QRS duration of a left bundle branch morphology and a QRS duration of 130 milliseconds and above, with a left ventricular ejection fraction of 30% and less, derive not only a reduction in morbidity, but also mortality by giving a CRT pacing alone. But you need to decide when to give a defibrillator in this subset of patients. On the other hand, when the QRS duration of a non-LBBB morphology is there in more than 150, they have a significant impact on reduction of hospitalization with a little reduction in mortality. How about other conditions? When you are considering a patient who has had a prior pacemaker with an EF of, say, 50% at implant, which has come down to around 35% during a box change, when the generator needs to be changed and the EF has dropped to around 35% or less, it's prudent to consider an upgrade of the device to a CRT if the patient is symptomatic. Similarly, if you have a de novo implantation, this we see it very often. Patients with, say for example, cardiomyopathy, infiltrative cardiomyopathies or post-congenital heart disease repairs, they come with an ejection fraction of around 40%, 35% with an AV block. In these patients, it's better to consider a de novo implantation of a CRT in these patients because block HF trial has shown a significant improvement in hospitalization and better remodeling of the LV. This is an important pie diagram to look at patients with different forms of QRS, because in this era of doing procedure after procedure on these patients, I mean, the technology is what is driving medicine. That should not be the case, because if you're a physician leader, please, for example, pause and consider whether it's required or not. If you take a person with normal QRS duration, whatever it is, you will end up having more than 90% of the people as non-responders if you start implanting a CRT. On the other hand, if you have a left bundle branch morphology, close to about 85% of them will be a responder, with 17% being non-responders. If you take patients with a right bundle branch morphology, about 50 to 60% of them will be responders, and 40% of them would be, 40% will be responders and 60 would be non-responders. In IVCD, again, about you will have 30% responder. Now, let me just pause, and I'm just going to dwell a little time on this. Why is there such a heterogeneity in the clinical response that you see in patients among non-LBBB morphology? If you take patients with an LBBB morphology, the moment the left bundle is blocked, there is a unifocal spread from the septum to the lateral wall, and anywhere along the lateral wall, if you place a lead, the LBBB is more forgiving. If you put it as a little anterior, posterior, mid-lateral vein, you will still have a benefit. On the other hand, that doesn't happen if you have a non-LBBB morphology. For some of the practicing physicians, especially for some of the postgraduates, this is an important slide. This was way back described in ECG text. If you take two patients with a right bundle branch morphology, patients with a QRBBB in lead V1 and RBBB in V1, one has a significant S wave in lead 1, indicating there is a delayed left to right activation causing a slurred S wave in lead 1. That is a typical right bundle branch block. On the other hand, if you have this patient where the delayed activation doesn't happen in the left bundle, and these are the patients which are considered to be bilateral bundle branch block. So even though patient has got or called a masquerading bundle branch block, if you have a person with a right bundle branch block with a left axis deviation and absence of S wave, this patient will still respond to cardiac resynchronization therapy, even though the V1 morphology is of right bundle morphology. But the other common reason why we find, even in our own practice, why some of these patients who are supposed to respond, they don't respond, is the simple reason, unlike a pacemaker, for CRT to respond, the patient should be pacing the left ventricle 100% of the times. If you even have less than 90% reduction, 10% reduction in pacing rate of the LV, it affects your total mortality and the survival is less in that. So it's important as a physician to ensure that there is 100% of a left ventricular capture. This is data from Cleveland Clinic. Millens looked at over about 30,000 patients to look at what are the common reasons why the CRT fails to deliver. And the commonest reason is patients with heart failure, you and me know, very often have PVCs, PACs, frequent runs of atrial flutter fibrillation, which limits the delivery of the cardiac resynchronization therapy. You have done a great job. You have put an expensive device, but it's not delivering its work. And therefore, the patients, this happens fairly frequently among patients with heart failure. So if you look at patients among non-responders of CRT, apart from suboptimal AV delay that is programmed, frequent reason for non-responder is an arrhythmia and suboptimal LV lead position. We'll address this one by one. Now, you know that some of these patients with cardiomyopathy or an old infarct are likely to have fibrosis, especially mid-wall fibrosis in the left ventricle. This is emerging as an important risk factor for non-response among CRT. The present issue of JACC has this mid-wall fibrosis in left ventricle. If you have a significant scar in the place where you implant a left ventricular lead, you find that mortality goes up compared to implanting a lead in a non-scarred area. So you may be getting into a lateral vein very easily. Please don't park that lead there if you expect that area to be scarred. 100% the morbidity events will be much higher in those patients. Similarly, the whole premise of cardiac resynchronization therapy is to activate or depolarize the area where there is a latest depolarization of the ventricle. So if you find that you have implanted a lead away, very far remote from the area of latest activation, actually their mortality is much higher compared to a place, a person where the lead was implanted at the latest site of activation. So a simple tool, if you don't implant the lead in the latest area of activation, please pull out the lead. It may take another half an hour, it doesn't matter, it's well worth it. There are occasional instances, about 5% in our practice, that we end up sending a patient for an epicardial procedure, not because we can't implant the LV lead, but we think it won't electrically resynchronize that area. How do you recognize that? It's very simple. You look at the sensed bipolar electrogram, which indicates the local electrical activation from the LV lead, and ask the programmer, the Medtronic or whichever company guy is there, ask him to display a QRS, and you should be able to sense this local LV depolarization at the end of the QRS so that you can have optimal repolarization. Now, this is a very nice work which was recently published from France, which tells you about the heterogeneity that I was talking to you about non-ischemic cardiomyopathy. Because every one of you here would have seen an occasional patient with non-ischemic cardiomyopathy and an IVCD, not an LBBB, who has responded, and conversely, who has not responded. Why does this happen? So if you look at patients with an IVCD, you have a uniform action of the septum. This is an AP view. There is an area of conduction block, and the impulse has to go around either through the anterior or the inferior wall and activate the lateral wall. This, what you see as this magenta purple color, indicates a very late activation of the ventricle. So, and the commonest reason in cardiomyopathy is because they have mid-wall fibrosis, and the fibrosed area acts as conduction block, and therefore the impulse activates this area very, very late. If you by chance have a vein either in this location or in this location, it is lateral wall. You have parted it anatomically in a lateral location, but you won't be able to depolarize this area of latest area of activation. So in other words, if you want to resynchronize a non-LBBB patient, you need to spend a little more time with your echocardiographer, with your MRI person, and then be willing to post him as the first case when you have a little more time on your hand to kind of choose the optimal vein to implant the lead. One way of overcoming this is technically, if it is all in the course of one vein, you can have a multi-site pacing among the LV. That is, this is called a multi-point pacing. This is used for patients who are considered to be non-responders. You can pace the LV itself from more than one site so that you can recruit a larger area of the left ventricular myocardium at the area of latest activation. And this results in a significant improvement in terms of responder rate. So, Chairman, ladies and gentlemen, in conclusion, I would like to conclude that all of you know that cardiac resynchronization therapy is an established therapy, over 10,000 patients randomized, and it's extremely useful in patients with poor left ventricular function and wide QRS on the ECG. However, do not recommend this for a person with systolic heart failure and narrow QRS. For non-LBBB patients, don't brush them aside saying that they are not going to be responders. Please spend time with your echocardiographer. Please get an MRI done to make sure there's no scar in the lateral wall. Then you may pick up some of those patients who are likely to respond even though they don't have a typical left bundle branch block. And please, left ventricular lead in a good target site is an important and an imperative factor to deliver the maximum amount of cardiac resynchronization therapy. That's an important technical factor that all of you can easily decide on the table by looking at the delay of the local ventricular electrical activation, which will tell you whether you're at the right spot or not. Thank you very much for the patient listening.